This next topic is, does Christianity provide a basis for science? So what do you want to say about that?
I would say that, just trying to get my notes.
I mean,
I would say that Christianity provides the basis for science in terms of a structure, that, you know, the laws of causality and things like that. If God is, if the assumption is that God has created the world and set in motion, then it gives a reason why there are these laws, that these laws are not just going to disappear tomorrow. So it gives you an account for causality. And secondly, the Christianity, from my understanding, being in seminary, two seminaries. One seminary was liberal, where there were gay lecturers, where there were people attacking the Bible. And for me, Christianity teaches me to study widely and to investigate. And you can see throughout history, Christians have encouraged scholarship. And so I don't see any problem about science and about Christianity not wanting to be involved in science or promote science.
Okay, well, let me just address you right there. I mean, to me, I think it's kind of hilarious to hear Christians say they have no problem with science, and yet they have these big problems with science. For example, all of modern biology, which is firmly accepting evolutionary theory that humans evolved from other animals, and you reject that. So here you are wanting to say that, you know, basically thank God for science, because of God we have science, but now you reject modern science. And you probably, if you're a young earther, if you believe the universe is 6,000 years old, you're off by a factor of 3 million. It's because it's about 18 billion years old. So it's kind of hilarious to say that you think Christianity is a form for science, but yet you deny modern science.
Well, I don't demand, for me, I'm not a scientist. So for me, I'm not, that is not my professional basis. Me, it's historical Jesus studies. Get me on that, and know what I'm talking about. But I've listened to eight of your talks, eight of your debates. I've listened to them carefully, and I've tried, I've set aside a full day, I've tried to do a bit of research and a bit of study on the topic. So I can't even begin to fully address those issues. All I know is that from a mathematical point of view, mutation and natural selection does not make sense. And even in recent research, if you study recent studies on the rate of mutation and how mutations stay within a gene pool, and the problems that scholarship's recently having in that area, that the time factor for a mutation to stay within a gene and to have a long-term effect, if you calculate the mathematical probability in just one species, statistics go way billions and billions of years beyond what current scientists think. So in other words, you've got problems with your model as well.
Well, this is not. These calculations are not a problem with evolutionary theory. You cannot calculate or predict evolutionary changes. I mean, it has to do with isolation. Species change when they're isolated, the gene pool drifts. You can't calculate these things because they happen by random events. Migrations, could be volcanoes, meteor hits, or whatever. I mean, you can't predict these things.
So if you study the current research in genetics and about how mutations, if you just Google that and study recent current mathematical models and the issue about mutation and the effect of mutation, the rate of mutation, if you study the current scholarship on that, there's about five or six different views, different papers that have been written recently. So not by creationists, but mainstream evolutionists.
Well,
and in that, just for one species, it goes millions and millions of years beyond what current formulations are. So, and they're all different. Some it's like astronomical bigger, astronomical smaller. In other words, the issue on mathematics and its relationship to mutation and natural selection.
No, it's not a done deal.
It's not as done as you are making it out to be in current scholarship.
No, I think that's totally bogus. I mean, there is a such
it's
thing
not,
as
it's not bogus.
Let me finish now. Let me talk a little bit. I let you talk. Let me finish. Let me say a little bit.
Sorry.
It is true that you can calculate some things, like those molecular clocks. You can see how things have changed over time. There's certain theories about that. But there's also things that are unpredictable, like horizontal gene transfer, where you can pick up totally foreign DNA. So in other words, this is DNA in your genome that is not even passed down from descendants. And there's no way to calculate that. So and there could be all kinds of duplications, too, in the genome. There's these things that happen that just you cannot calculate. So that's why I think it's totally bogus to try to calculate species
change. Well, the academic article, because let's put a bit of substance on it. If you go to John Sanford, Wesley Brewer, and Francis Smith, published 17th of September 2015, and it's called The Waiting Time Problem in Model hominin something, I can't. But if you Google John Sanford and Brewer and Smith on the waiting time problem, and you know that's just one article with many articles on that topic, and they're trying to base what they do know, not what they don't know. And you're quite right, there are factors that you can't calculate, but they're trying to work from what they do know, and from what they do know, the statistics don't add up. And if you take your argument, you know, you're using that argument to try and get out of the problem. You're not using that argument to actually engage with the scholarship. You're frightened of the scholarship. You're using it to get out of the argument. Deal with what we know. And what we know is mutations and natural selection, mathematically speaking, when we start to apply it to how mutations stay and affect species, you know, it doesn't add up from what they know, and they're doing minute research on these areas.
Okay, you send me the link after the show, and I'll put it in the show notes. And of course, I'll look at that.
I'll have to do it later this afternoon. Yeah. As soon as I finish, I'm going to go to bed.
I mean, I have a feeling you're misrepresenting the data. If it's valid science, it may be invalid pseudoscience too. So I'm going to check it out.
Okay.
But William Dembski is famous for talking about the odds of life arising and stuff like that. And I know the equations he's using are bogus because I've seen what he's done. And also Bart Rask, I've debated him. He wrote a big book about it, and I can see how his equations are bogus. And I see people repeating these arguments about how things are calculated. And all of them I looked at so far, they're bogus. So
Bernie, you don't have to. Bernie, you're an intelligent guy with a degree in engineering. You don't have to be that smart. You're smart. It's just common sense. But
No, it's not common sense.
Wait a minute. I've thought about this for years that's been a problem. And when I went into studying it, because I've heard your lectures and debates, I went to study it for myself and looked at the current scholarship, I was quite encouraged. And glad to find that my own thinking as an ordinary person on the street is being confirmed by modern scholarship.
Yeah, this stuff is not common science. This can be complicated things. I mean, it's like, you know, like quantum mechanics. People don't understand it, but they have to accept it even though it doesn't make sense. I understand it's hard to believe that we came from ape-like creatures and before that from fish. That is not common sense, but that's where the evidence leads. And so you cannot appeal to common sense for science. I mean, in common sense, we would not think the Earth is spinning at something like 60,000 miles per hour because we don't feel it. So there's
In the article, it says this. Various researchers have examined the issue of waiting time and approached the problem from different directions using different starting assumptions. So that's on one issue.
Will you send me the link on that?
Okay. Yes, certainly, sir.
All right. Thank you. So anyway, just in summary, I think it's kind of amazing that you would say thank God that he created science. Science owes everything to God, and yet here we have modern science, and Christians such as yourself deny it. Like, modern evolutionary theory is modern science, and you're saying that's bogus. And yet
your
this is modern science.
Your main argument that you based evolution on has been about chromosome 2 or something like that. I'm only a layman. You've studied it in more detail. But I've just tried to look at the current scholarship on one particular area, and I'm finding problems. I'm not coming at this as a person who wants to prove creationism. I just want to study current scholarship, and it's showing me that it's not as clear as you're making out
to
be.
Well, let me ask you a question. Do you think it's a scientific fact that humans evolved from other animals?
You need to qualify what you mean.
No, I don't. I said humans evolved from other...
There's evolution in time that we can see, and then there's evolution in species over long periods of time.
No, I'm talking specifically humans. Did humans evolve from other animals?
From what I've just studied in current scholarship, it doesn't add up mathematically.
Is it? So you're saying it is not a scientific fact that humans descended from other animals?
From what I've just studied here, from what I've studied about mutations and how the variations of mutations.
Okay, but I'm trying to tell you I'm trying to tell you it is a scientific fact that humans descended from other animals. How did it happen? That is evolutionary theory. It's a theory and it's always being revised. How it happened. Let me finish.
Make a statement about something.
Jason, let me finish.
I ask you to back it up.
Jason.
You've not backed it up.
Let me finish. I'm trying to say there's two points here. One point is it's a scientific fact that humans evolved from other animals. The second thing is how did it happen? That's evolutionary theory and it's constantly being revised. For example, horizontal gene transfer is another thing that kind of came in with descent and modification. So the complexity, how it actually happened is evolutionary theory, but that it happened is a fact. And if you don't believe that humans descended from other animals, then you are not in modern science. And so that's why I think it's Christianity brought us modern science, and yet you deny modern science.
Bernie, let me come in. You sound like a modern prophet or something, just banging on. You failed to give us any data. I know you're going to say chromosome, whatever, but you've not given us any data. You just said fact, but no data. I've given you current scholarship in a particular area.
You gave one criticism of evolutionary theory, but for example, in the United States, every single university teaches that humans evolved from other animals. Every single university, no exceptions whatsoever, state universities.
It's established fact. The theory of science, that science just doesn't stand still, it moves on. And this current scholarship in the mathematical implications of the mutation rate on the weight in time, it is very dangerous and is strategic. And if the current scholarship is correct, it makes all the stuff that you're claiming nonsense.
Okay, next, the next topic is